So how exactly did this day become known as Good Friday? The worst day in history is now the day that we call good. This was the question that our daughter had last week in our family devotion. Daddy, why is it so good if this is the day that Jesus died? Maybe this is a question that you've had. Why in the world is this called Good Friday? Maybe this is a question that you've had in a little bit of a different kind of way, in a way that asks, can anything good come out of everything that's so bad in my life? Maybe you've wondered, can God do anything good with all of the bad that's just consuming my life? Can God do anything good with all of the bad that I've done, that's my fault, that's my responsibility, that's happened in my life? And if God can do anything about it, will he? Maybe your question has more been along the lines of, does God even see, does God know any of the brokenness and evil that goes on in our world today? And if God does know all of the wrong that's happening in our world today, does he even care? And if God does care, can he even do anything about it? If you've ever had any questions like these, if you've ever wondered if God can do anything good in the midst of so much bad, look no further than the cross. Because the cross is, in fact, why we still, to this day, call this day Good Friday. Because it's the cross that we're reminded that God does his greatest work in the midst of the darkest of times. On Good Friday, we celebrate the goodness of God in the evil that surrounds us. The cross is the work of God because of the love of God, so that we can forever be with God. But couldn't God, in all of his power, he created everything around, couldn't God, in all of his goodness and kindness and mercy, chosen some other way than the cross? Why in the world did Jesus have to die on the cross? Well, friends, that is exactly why today is known as Good Friday. Jesus had to die on the cross for several reasons that we're going to unpack tonight as we focus our hearts, as we focus our minds, as we focus our gaze on the goodness of the cross. So why did Jesus have to die? If you're taking notes, number one, Jesus had to die to reveal the wealth of God's love for sinners. Did you know that God loves sinners? Did you know that God actually cares compassionately, deeply, profoundly? He loves sinners. So much so that his son, whom he sent, was known as the friend of sinners. And this wasn't something that sinners and tax collectors kind of collectively said, hey, let's try to partner up with him. It seems like his movement is moving in the right direction. It seems like he's going in the right way. We better buddy up with this guy. No, he was called the friend of sinners. Ironically, even though we sing it as followers of Jesus, he was called the friend of sinners by the religious leaders. The Pharisees would kind of lob this out there as a dig against Jesus because they wanted everybody else to see this guy is hanging out with these sinners, these tax collectors. And so Jesus was known far and wide, bless you, far and wide, as the friend of sinners. Which means for you and for me today, where we're at, this means that God loves us no matter where we're at. That God loves us no matter where we've been. That God loves us no matter what we've done or what's been done to you. God loves you as you are, not as you should be, because guess what? None of us are as we should be. Christianity is the only faith in the history of mankind where God loves, befriends, even invites into his family sinners. Jesus said that he came to earth to seek and to save that which was lost. There was a time when Jesus was at a party and he was gathered at this party and all the religious leaders were kind of gathered around the party, not close enough to get dirty by those who were in the party, but close enough to be able to say to Jesus, why are you hanging out with all these people? Hey, Jesus, why are you doing life with these convicts? Jesus, why are you at a party with sinners? And Jesus, understanding what they were talking about, whether he overheard it or not, Jesus in this moment leans into the religious leaders and says, guys, it's not the healthy who need a doctor. It's the sick. Jesus leans in this moment that's captured in three of the Gospels to say that I came not for the righteous. I didn't come to call the righteous, Jesus says. By the way, there's no one who's righteous. There are only those who are self-righteous and self-deceived. Friends, the very prerequisite, the requirement to receive Jesus into your life is that you are a sinner, which means all of us are overqualified there. Paul says it this way in Romans chapter 5, if you've got your Bibles with you. Paul says it this way in Romans chapter 5. He says, but God shows his love for us and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Now look at the very intentional, purposeful, practical verbiage that Paul uses here. Paul says that God shows his love for us. He shows, he demonstrates, he models, Paul says. And this is incredible because God doesn't just talk about loving us. He doesn't just preach on loving us and give some cute spiritual examples to show and harp on and continue just to go down this path. Guys, I love you, I love you, I love you, I'm telling you, I love you. He doesn't just talk about it. Paul says that God demonstrates, that he models, that he shows that he loves us. This way, there's no question in our minds that God loves us. If God would have just talked about this love, there could be kind of a bit of ambiguity here that, okay, God talked about the fact that he loves sinners, but what did he actually mean there? And what did the original Greek and Hebrew mean there? And what was the extent of God's love and who all is included in sinners? God talks about loving us. And no, this isn't just ambiguous talking about loving sinners. Paul says that God shows his love for sinners. It's not that God showed in the past tense. That one point in history, there was a group of people that God chose to love. No, it's not a past tense thing. It's not a future looking ahead thing that God at some point with some unknown group of people will eventually love a group of people. No, it's God shows his love for us. And that while we were still sinners, and that while we were still unlovable, while we were still a mess, while we were still choosing to actively pursue everything opposite of God, God shows us his love then. Not when he sees that we're lovely, not that he finally recognizes we're lovable, or we've reached a point of potentially being lovely. No, God shows his love while we were still sinners. And he shows us because Christ died for us. God is currently showing us right now that he still loves us. Now, in order for us to kind of grasp this whole concept that Paul is talking about in this one verse of scripture, we got to understand that God is outside of time. God transcends time. Think back to the time when God is speaking to Moses through the burning bush. You may remember this if you've gone to any Sunday school class, heard any Bible story. There's a bush on fire. Moses walks up to it and it starts talking to him. This is reality. This isn't like some psychedelic trip or anything. This is happening. God's speaking to Moses and says, hey, go tell Pharaoh, the most powerful person on planet Earth at that time, go tell him to let my people go. And Moses, in all of his wisdom, just kind of steps back to say, well, okay, God, that's fine. Okay, let's say I take you at your word, God. Who should I tell this Pharaoh sent me? What am I going to say when he says, who's behind all of this? And God says to Moses, tell him that I am sent you. Break this down just a little bit. God is before now. God is right now, and God will be after now. God transcends time, which means that for you and I today, we can take a verse like this. God shows his love for us, and it means for you and I today that we can read this verse personally. Because while Jesus died 2,000 years ago, it involves you personally today because God knew your name in that moment and he loves you in this moment. That's why it's Good Friday. He proves, demonstrates, models, shows us that he loves us. You see, we deserved divine punishment, but instead God gave us divine grace. He gave us divine sacrifice. Instead of punishing us like we deserve, he gave us sacrifice in the form of his son's life on the cross. But you see, what we do is we tend to overestimate our own goodness and think, you know what? If we can just kind of balance out the good with the bad that we do, maybe by the time we show up at some hypothetical pearly gates at the end of our life, then the good will balance out the bad. And we tend to overestimate our own goodness and underestimate God's goodness and God's holiness. God is the only, the one and only holy requirement. But the good news is to be with God is to be holy. It's perfection. When you and I couldn't work our way to God, God in love and mercy and grace and patience and tenderness and compassion worked his way to us when we couldn't work our way to him. You see, you and I are more sinful than we could possibly imagine. And yet we're more loved than we ever dared to hope. Why is Good Friday good? Because God shows us just how much he loves us. But also, Good Friday is good. Jesus died on the cross, number two, to provide forgiveness for our sins. Right in the middle of this word forgiveness is the word in the English language called give. Paul says it this way in Ephesians chapter 1. Verse 7, he says, in him, in Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, of our sins, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and in all insight. The cross is this beautiful dichotomy, right? It's this beautiful picture of the great tragedy because we understand the reality of sin that requires a sacrifice like this. It's a great tragedy. And the other side of the dichotomy is it's a beautiful, beautiful picture of grace because of just how much God cares for us. Forgiveness is costly. Forgiveness isn't just like something that we can grab like a free chocolate on a table. Forgiveness is costly in a cosmic sense because it cost God greatly. It cost him his only son, but forgiveness is also costly between us and other people that we're in relationship with. The Bible teaches that forgiveness means to cancel the debt. Jesus, right in the middle of the Lord's Prayer, He says, forgive us our debts as we have forgiven those with debts in us. Forgive us our trespasses. Forgive us of our sins, just like we've forgiven the sins of those who've been committed against us. 1 John chapter 4, verse 10 says it this way. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. Now let's take a hypothetical. Let's say that there's someone on trial for murder. And this person is on trial and like it's crystal clear. It's not like OJ kind of trial. Like it's absolutely clear, like murder has happened and this guy's responsible. And let's say that the judge and the jury even convict him guilty of murder. And let's say at the end of this, after he's been convicted, he walks up to the judge's bench and says, hey, you know what, Judge, I'm just so sorry. I'm really sorry that I did that. Imagine for a minute if the judge in that moment were to say, oh, it's okay. Oh, you're forgiven. Just don't do it again. Don't worry about it though. It's fine. You're sorry. It's fine. Where would the justice in that be? Where would the justice that the judge is tasked with executing, where would it be? There would be no justice, but justice has to be served. What about the person who was murdered? What about the family who lost a loved one? What about justice? If you do the crime, you've got to do the time. But listen to me. The beauty of Good Friday is that the cross is where love and justice meet. Do you know who crucified Jesus? Do you know who crucified Jesus? Maybe for some of you would say it's the Roman soldiers, right? They had kind of adapted some things historically about crucifixion. They'd kind of, some historians would even say that the Romans had perfected the art of killing someone through crucifixion. No, the Romans didn't. Maybe some would say that the Jewish religious leaders crucified Jesus. But I would posit to you tonight that neither of those would be guilty. You know who crucified Jesus? God did. Let me show you what I'm talking about. In Isaiah 53, before Jesus was ever even around on earth, before Jesus came as a baby at Christmas, this is what was promised, prophesied, that would come true. Read it with me in Isaiah 53, verse 4. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken and smitten by God and afflicted. This is talking about the coming Savior, the Messiah, the rescuer, Jesus. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. With his wounds we are healed. All of we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that's led to the slaughter, like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Grab your highlighter, your pen, your neighbor's lipstick. This is where it's at. Verse 10, yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. The cross is the work of God because of the love of God so that we could be forever with God. What Jesus did in this moment, in this text that was promised before he showed up at Christmas, what Jesus did was he absorbed all of the wrath of God on our behalf. This is this great doctrinal truth, this great theological truth of the substitutionary atonement, that Jesus was the propitiation of our sin, that when it was our moment to be called guilty, he stepped in for us and said, no, that's mine, I'll take that. That is the good news of Good Friday. It is what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5. As he's writing to a church in great disarray, he says this, for our sake, he, God, made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him, in Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. The Bible teaches that there is a penalty for sin, and that penalty is death. In the Old Testament, they would sacrifice animals. They would pick the very best lamb that they had, and they would sacrifice and kill this lamb in order to pay for a sin or several sins in some certain amount of time. And because of the shedding of blood, there was forgiveness of sins. Scripture says in Hebrews chapter 9, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. And so they would bring a lamb. And then we're reminded that Jesus is called the Lamb of God. The penalty of sin is death. And so what God did as the judge of the universe, where justice must be served, God got up off of the judge's seat and came down to where we are. We're found guilty, and yet he paid the fine for us. The wages of sin is death, and God died in your place. Jesus paid a debt that he did not owe, because you and I could never pay the debt. Forgiveness is costly because justice still must be served. And so Jesus absorbed the wrath of God on our behalf. Why the cross? Because it's God revealing his love for sinners and providing the forgiveness of our sins. But why the cross? Well, number three, to make us holy. There's this idea in religious circles, in spiritual circles, and maybe even American Christian culture. There's this idea that the people who go to heaven, the people who get to heaven, are the good people. Here's the problem with that. It's not true. Think about it with me. Stick with me. Hang on there with me. If you think about it, the requirement for getting to heaven is holiness, perfection. Religion, on one hand, gives us some advice. Religion says, this is what you have to do to work your way to God. Do a little bit more good. Be your own savior. Make sure the good in your life outweighs the bad in your life by the time you hit the pearly gates. The only problem is, this is not what the Bible teaches. This is not the gospel, because the gospel is good news. And that, friends, is overwhelming news. If this is up to me, if I gotta figure this out on my own, we're up a creek without a paddle. But the gospel is good news. Good Friday is a good news day, because what happens when you say yes to Jesus is that when you trust in Jesus, he takes on himself all of your sin and gives you all of his perfection and his holiness and his righteousness. Not so that we become perfect on this side of heaven, but because when we get to heaven, God will see our holiness because of the goodness of Jesus. The Spirit of Jesus covers you with his perfection. He covers you with his holiness. And so if you and I die today, and we're standing at the gates of heaven, I'm just telling you right now that Peter is not gonna be there saying, you know what, why should I let you in? No, whatever happens when we show up to heaven, if we are in Christ, if we have put our trust and our faith in Jesus, then what is seen is Jesus and his goodness. That is what God has done through Christ on the cross. And so what happens is, when we say yes to Jesus, we get his goodness and righteousness. It's literally like Jesus clothes us with his Spirit, and he wraps us up so that when God sees us, he sees Jesus. And when he sees Jesus, he sees perfection. He sees holiness and righteousness. And it's not because we're good, it's because Jesus is good. It's not because we're worthy, it's because Jesus is worthy. It's not because we're holy and all put together and know all of the right answers to Jesus Jeopardy. No, it's none of that, because it's because Jesus is holy and he has covered us with his holiness. When Jesus breathed his last breath, scripture says that he gave up his spirit. And he gave up his spirit so that you and I could receive his spirit, so that you and I could experience brand new life. Jesus died, the perfect for the imperfect, so that we could actually live. It is the great exchange that we call the gospel. Again, going back to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul captures this exchange this way. He says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. This verse is what makes Christianity different than every other faith in the history of mankind. Religion says you earn it. Biblical Christianity says you receive it. We receive his goodness. The cross shows us the depth of God's love for sinners. The cross is so that God can offer us forgiveness. The cross is so that he can make us holy. Jesus can impart his holiness to us. And finally this, the cross, so that you and I can receive eternal life. Why did Jesus have to die to give us eternal life? Maybe you've heard this verse before. It's arguably one of the most famous verses in all Christianity. It shows up on poster boards. It shows up at WrestleMania. It shows up on Tim Tebow's eye black. But as familiar as you may be with this verse, I just want to invite you to take a fresh look at it with me tonight. John 3:16 says this, for God so loved, there's that love, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, so that whoever believes in him would never perish but have eternal life. And notice with me that the very first word here is God. God so loved. And the very last word is life. The cross is the work of God, because of the love of God, so that you and I could be forever with God. God so loved the world that he gave. Right in the middle of this verse is this word again, gave. Right in the middle of forgive is the word give. And so if you trust in Jesus, not in your own goodness, not in your own holiness, not in your own rightness or in your own worthiness, if you believe in Jesus, then you will not perish, but you can have eternal life. Why is Good Friday good? Because Jesus changed everything. I'll never forget the first time I laid eyes on my now wife, Kara. I saw this beautiful, kind, compassionate woman who loves Jesus with all her heart. And I knew from the moment I saw her, I had to go up and meet her. I have got to get to know her. And so for the first time in my career, after a 2-hour spiritual gifts assessment, I volunteered very willingly to do data input and go through all of the paperwork from this spiritual gifts assessment so that I could get her phone number. See, y'all think I was born at night, but I wasn't born last night. And so I got her phone number through a spiritual gifts assessment and found her name in a stack of over 100 names. And I called her and said, hey, Kara, I'd like to meet and talk about ministry. And so I got to know Kara. We started to hang out. And I knew that there was something different about the way that I felt about her. I knew that I cared about her and loved her, that led me to want to be with her more and more and more. And so I finally mustered up the courage to ask her out on a date. I woke up one morning on a Tuesday morning. I'll never forget it. I woke up and packed a picnic lunch for two because I had this grand romantic plan to be able to take her to the botanical gardens. And we have this nice picnic and there's birds and butterflies flying all around. And so I packed the lunch, threw it in a cooler. A couple hours later from my desk, I get on the phone and say, "Hey, Kara, I'd like to take you out on a date. I'd like to take you out for lunch." And she said, "No." She said, I'm gonna go on a walk with my friend instead. And so that day I sat at my cubicle under the stairwell of the music wing of the church I was serving at and ate a picnic lunch for two all by myself. Now, before you feel too sorry for me, like, spoiler alert, we ended up getting married and having babies, and we're fine, okay? But 2 days after that, after I had eaten this lunch all by myself, I looked at myself in the mirror on a Thursday and said, "Today is the day that the Lord has made." And so I packed a picnic lunch for two with Pepsi and Cheetos, some of her favorite things at that time. I get on the phone and call and say, "Hey, Kara, I'd like to take you out on a date for lunch." And she said, "No." She said, "I'm going to go get my nails done today." And so at this point, like, my persistence kicked in and I'm like, okay, this is not the end of this story. I said, "Look, you have to eat lunch at some point today. Just eat lunch with me." And so she did. And we had lunch, a picnic lunch that day in the botanical gardens in Virginia Beach. And then several months later, we were engaged at the Rose Garden at the White House. And 15 years later, we are still greatly in love. I knew they were cheering for you. I knew the moment that I met her that I loved her. And because I loved her, I didn't call my friends together and say, "Hey, could one of you guys go over and like set up a date for me and Kara?" I didn't call my family or my friends. I didn't have my coworkers fill in the gap for me in that moment. Because when it comes to love, you must go yourself. Which is exactly what God did for you and for me. He didn't send an angel on his behalf. He didn't send a fill-in or a prophet or someone with some religious advice to kind of help us in tough times. No, because he loved us, he came himself. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son so that us today on Good Friday, those of us who believe in him should never perish but have eternal life. This, friends, is why it's called Good Friday. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for the depth of love that you have for us. We are grateful that you chose in your great wisdom, in your great compassion, to send Jesus because of your love for us. And so God, today, I pray for the person who hasn't experienced the goodness of this day for themselves. God, I pray today for the person who has thought that it was about religion, had thought that it's about church attendance, that it's about doing something, becoming someone, being good enough. God, I pray that you would remind them, even in this moment, that you sent Jesus to die on the cross because you loved us, because you want to offer us forgiveness, to make us more like Jesus, and to bring us into eternal life with you. We thank you for this. We thank you for Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.